Our teachers go above and beyond. At this production on Friday night when I went, there was a group from Killam Elementary School that is called the Killam Mentors, and they are teachers who have connected with students and provide additional support and opportunities for one-to-one connections. And they were in a section of the auditorium and having a great time. And it was just, I want to give them a shout out for doing this on their own time, using their own antenna for what's really needed. So thank you, teachers. And then I also wanted to report on the Human Relations Advisory Committee meeting. That was last Thursday night. And so a shout out goes to a committee who, at that meeting, we voted to accept a human rights resolution that was worked on by a group of people who came to us before Martin Luther King Day. And because we didn't have the bandwidth to help them with it, we gave them our feedback and advice. They took it, they completely changed it, rewrote it into, I think, a really solid human rights resolution. We voted to accept it at our meeting, and we will make it available to everyone. It's not yet on our Facebook page, but we will be putting it up there. And you can find it at your houses of worship, so you can sign it if you'd like. There's also a Dropbox for it. If you want information on that, you can write to me on the school committee and I can make it available to you. And I have proposed that the school committee include this on our agenda so that the school committee would be able to also vote on supporting this resolution. Right now it is, as I understand it, going to the town council. So after it goes through the town council, I'm hoping that we can get it on our agenda for our meeting. Then also we're still working on the structure of our committee, and Kevin Sexton, selectman liaison, came to the last meeting. We had a discussion, and coming to our March 2nd meeting is Senator Jason Lewis, and he will be doing sort of a, what we want is like a workshop style on the human rights resolution and also on our structure of our committee. So everybody is welcome. It's a way to get involved. We'd love to have you there. And the third thing from our meeting is that, oh, there are two more. This Friday, there is a meeting of the Massachusetts Association of Human Rights Commissions, which I go to regularly. It's once a month on a Friday. I am going this Friday, so if anybody is interested, they're going to have a speaker that is intended to help us empower in a difficult time, to work together for the best of everybody, human rights. And so that's from 9:30 to 11:30 on Friday. Another thing you can contact me about if you're interested. And March 14th is Metco Lobby Day, and we need our legislators to support the Metco funding every year. They cut it, and then they put some back, maybe. We can't afford that. So if I'm planning to go to that, and so if people want to contact me and the HRAC about that as well. It's March 14th. And I believe it starts at 9 at the State House. And if I have enough people, I probably will drive. So, and I believe it goes till noon. And we will meet with our legislators when we go. And I think that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other liaison reports from the committee? Dr. Doherty.
Does anybody have anything? Go ahead.
Thank you. I'll just provide a quick update. So last week, the Special Ed Parent Advisory Council had a meeting on Tuesday. We had a business meeting. The focus was on trying to get some dates nailed down for the rest of the year. One topic the group would like to have a presentation on is from our school psychologists and really understanding the evaluation process and the role they play in the evaluation. So we're working on that date. We do have a business meeting scheduled for March 11th, and the hope is that Laura Gem is going to come.
She
is coming to present on open meeting law for the officers. So that's really going to be great. And then we also talked about doing some potential coffee and conversations with myself at the building level, so that there would be opportunities for parents to ask questions and kind of have discussions. So that's the CPAC update. I wanted to just provide a quick professional development update. We're continuing to work with Alan Bloom, who's a retired professor from Simmons College. He's working with our staff on writing data-driven IEPs. He worked with the staff about two years ago, and we're having him come back, so staff are pretty excited about this. He's doing a full day with any staff who haven't spent the full day with him, and then he's spending time at individual buildings doing consultation with people on more building-specific issues. So last week he was at RMHS and also at Killam, and the staff were pretty excited to have him back to sort of help and problem solve with writing IEPs. And then the last piece is that through some grant funding, I'm starting a special ed district-wide data team. We're going to have our first meeting on February 15th. We're using a retired special ed director to help facilitate that, to look at some of our data and practices in special education. We have six teachers from all levels, kind of varying representation, as well as three of the team chairs and one building principal will be part of those discussions. And so I'll be using that to do some reporting out as well. We're going to use some of the recommendations from the Walker report, as well as some of our data and our patterns to see how we're operating. So it should be exciting, and we're hoping this will continue through grant funding to be able to continue that next year as well.
That's great. Thank you.
I have a couple things.
Okay.
This was in the Pathways newsletter 2 weeks ago. It's also, I know, been in the Chronicle that we had 41 students, Reading Public School students, that were recognized for the Globe Scholastic Art and Writing Awards. The Boston Globe has done this for years. A few years ago, they added the writing component, which I thought was a great idea, since it is a true talent to be able to write creatively. And so we had a lot of students from the high school, and it's too many names to mention.
Yep, no.
We had students that received honorable mention, Silver Key, Gold Key, as well as we also had students at Coolidge and Parker as well for writing, photography, ceramics and glass, drawing and illustration. There's a wide variety. So congratulations to all those students. And then in addition to that, we also had several students from the two middle schools and the high school whose artwork was on display at the State Transportation Building in Boston through Youth Art Month. And this is a national celebration held each year. It's going to be during March, and it emphasizes the value of art education for all children. So we also have several students whose artwork will be on display at the State Transportation Building as well. And obviously, none of this would be happening without the hard work and dedication of our teachers who are working with these students to really show their true skills. So thanks to the teachers for working with these students to make this happen. And then the only other piece I had to add is my office hours for this week. We're going to add a night meeting office hour. We did receive a suggestion from one parent who was not able to come to office hour meetings at the drop-off pickup times or on Saturdays. So we are adding an office hour at night. So this week it is Tuesday from 6 to 7 here. Thursday morning, 7:45 to 8:45 at Joshua Eaton. And then Saturday morning from 9 to 10 here.
Thanks, Dr. Doherty. Do you want to dive right into the quarterly? Actually, before you do that, I thought the awards from the Boston Globe were really impressive. That's a large number of kids to be recognized. And you were right that they're getting a lot of that at school from teachers who are helping develop all aspects of their talent, so it was a tremendous honor. Do you want to dive right into the quarterly personnel update?
So in your packet is a much smaller second quarter report.
Much
smaller, which is would be expected. You can see there's a variety of positions, mostly paraeducators, tutors. We do have a couple of teachers. We had a couple of retirements mid-year, which allowed for some transition. We do have some vacant positions, as you can see. They're mostly, there are some special education positions that are open. I know we are in the process of trying to fill those positions. One of them is the new position at Wood End, and the one at Joshua Eaton, we just filled. So I don't know if anyone has any specific questions. Jen Bove also put a breakdown for reasons for leaving, and then also the retirements that we've had this year. These are teachers that have retired during the school year this year.
A question on the reasons for leaving. When I looked at it, there's resignation, and then there's other leave of absence, transfer, new position.
Yep.
How can you delineate what that difference is?
So other means that they have left the current position they're in. Sometimes it's for a short period of time, like a leave of absence.
Okay.
So if they are on maternity leave.
Yep.
Others, they could be transferring to another position.
Within the district.
Within the district.
Okay.
Those are mostly within district.
Got it. And the new position is what confused me.
I believe the new position.
I didn't know if that meant within district. So I'm taking a new position within the district.
No, I think, no, that would be within the district, yes.
Okay, so that actually answers my question.
Yep.
So resignation means I am leaving the Reading School District, I'm going either not to work anymore or to
right.
work somewhere else.
Correct.
So the other all includes transitions
Correct.
Within. That's very helpful, thank you. Any other questions from the committee? Yeah, Mrs. Wen.
So on the first page, so how many of the people in that list are actually also still in the district doing other jobs? At least two, is that true? I'm just sort of wondering.
Yeah.
Is that right? Jen and Christian.
Jen and Christian, it looks like.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, and can I just one other question. So on the retirements, so does that mean, so these were retirements that you did not know about at the beginning of the school year or at the end of June 30th or July 1st?
I think it depends on the person. Some we did know about, but their retirement date was not on June 30th.
Okay.
It was during the year.
Mm-hmm.
They have okay. retired in the second quarter, which
yeah.
is why we're seeing them on
yeah.
this list.
Right.
So they began the school year here and then retired.
Different dates. Okay.
Yeah. I guess for maybe for future reports, and I think I saw something that may have been a little bit more detailed. I'm trying to grab it in the budget process. So, I want to be more clear on whether or not people are leaving because we don't pay enough or our salaries. And I hear that a lot. But I think we should see that in the numbers somewhere or see that in the data. So,
the data
rather
you're
than just
referring
lumping
to,
it under resignation.
The data you're referring to is actually in the questions.
Right.
We did have a specific question answered on that.
Right.
With specific data.
Okay. I thought I.
Yeah, it was, yes, you're correct. It was in there. It wasn't in the budget book because we wouldn't have had that information.
But someone asked the question and you
right.
provided the information. Did you have one, Mr. Poppin?
Yeah, I just had a question about the format. It's the first time I've seen one of these reports. So if we look at the table, I'm just trying to understand. I understand all the positions that have a person they're replacing. It's a kind of, I call it a backfill. Someone left, you hired someone to replace them.
Mm-hmm.
There's a few that are different than that. There's three here that are, two that are new. And one that's an NA, assume that means not applicable. Could you just explain for us the new positions, where they originated from, and the NAs, what does that mean?
The two new positions you knew about, pardon the pun, those we talked about during the budget process.
Okay.
One FTE special education at Wood End, mm-hmm. one FTE special education at Joshua Eaton.
So it's part of the FY17 budget.
Right. We had to hire them this year, but they were not in the original budget, which is why you heard about them in FY18.
Okay, and so they're hired now, but they're part of the FY18 budget. Can you just explain that? It's part of the FY18 budget, the new hires? We're just
No, they're being hired right now.
Okay.
But they were not in the original FY17 budget. These are positions that came about because of needs in at Wood End and Joshua Eatman. I don't know if you recall, we had this conversation in one of our budget meetings, probably the special education.
No, yeah, the positions are familiar to me. I just wanted to understand the process of hiring now in FY17.
We needed them now. That's why we hired them now.
And they are, because they're here now, they're then included in
FY18 budget.
And maybe they were not.
Okay, no, that makes sense, because you're planning to continue to pay them in FY18.
Yeah.
And the NA is what?
Speak to the NA.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that the teacher of reading? So we've had a vacancy, actually my entire tenure. We had someone who was a teacher of reading for the high school, and it was a very short period of time, and so there really hasn't been anyone in that position, so there's not a person that they're replacing. I think you'd have to go like 4 years back to find someone for that position. So I think that's why it's listed under replacing as NA.
So it was a new position, but it's also a new person?
It's not a new position. It's been a vacant position.
Existing headcount that was already there. We just weren't paying
for
it, and now we're finally filling it.
Yes, and we've been trying to fill, and we continually post.
It's still vacant.
And it continues to be vacant.
It's been a very challenging one for us to fill. Dr. Doxon?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but it's been a very challenging one, but I think you've used a very creative way to address it, because you have a teacher training to get her certification this year.
Yes.
So that if we don't find someone, or whichever way it goes, next year we will have someone that has her certification. And then in addition to that, there are other teachers that are doing their training, which doesn't qualify as a certification.
Right.
But they're also in the pipeline. So you haven't been sitting still on this. You've been working towards making sure it's filled, even if we don't find from outside.
Right, that's correct. And we still need that position, whether or not we fill it with someone internally, we would need to then fill for that person who takes over that. So we need the total number of FTEs at the high school. We've been, we've been contracting as well with an agency for a special education teacher. So that person, we've been using an agency to fill while we continue to post, because we still need to service the students.
Yes, Ms. Bobby.
Sorry, just counting names. I see 15 names here, but 18 on the next page. So we talk 18 people that have reasons for leaving, but 15 names on the first page. Is that just an artifact of when we do the count, or?
Yeah, there may be some positions not filled yet.
So it's three more people leaving than the names that we have on the first chart.
I don't think you're going to see an equal.
It's just when you take the snapshot
correct.
For the first chart,
correct.
When you took the snapshot for the second chart, and then in aggregate, it's all going to add up. This is what we have for this report. Thank you.
Anything else in the quarterly personnel? All right. Thank you, Dr. Doherty.
If I can just.
Sure.
This is the format the committee wanted from the previous time we did this.
Yes.
So I'm not sure if there's something different.
I like
this. This is what was recommended.
I like this better than the previous one.
Okay.
Speaking only for myself, the only.
And this is what is standard in most school districts. I had Jen do some research. She has talked to other people. She's also worked with her mentor on this. This is the standard report most school districts get for a personnel report.
The only thing, and I'll throw this out, I don't know if anyone on the committee agrees with me, the breakdown of reasons for leaving. I wouldn't mind seeing that year to date. So I'm less interested every quarter in a small number of staff turnover and why they're leaving, but I'd rather see the trend. So in quarter one, here's why people are leaving the district, and then take quarter two. I don't want to just see quarter two. I want to see quarter two added to quarter one. So what's the, I think you're going to get more from that data because the numbers are so small, but that's just.
Well, don't forget, quarter one is the summer.
Well, my point remains, like quarter three, quarter four. Just
right.
Having a year to date for a year so that at the end of the 12 months, you get the total reasons, I think would be helpful. But that's
okay.
Otherwise, I like this format a lot.
Just to make that chart year to date.
That's all.
Yeah.
Year to date.
Because
I don't think in any given 3 month period, you're going to get enough to, but following the trend over a year, I think would be more helpful. If anyone else disagrees.
I agree.
Thank you. can also think about it and let Dr. Doherty know afterwards. I do like this format a lot better, though. Thank you to Jennifer for looking into that. So we will now talk about the FY18 budget. A little over a week ago, we voted and approved a budget as a school committee. And in that budget, we made a request for free cash. The use of free cash, as approved by the Finance Committee, well, recommended by the Finance Committee and ultimately by town meeting. I want to kind of discuss as a committee what our next steps are. But I did want to make one clarification. There was some confusion in the public, I felt like, that the request for free cash meant that the school committee didn't want an override or believe we needed an override, and I felt the discussion was the exact opposite. The only way that a request for free cash works is if there is the expectation of an override at the end of a period of time. So I'll certainly throw that out. If anyone else has a different perspective, I'll take it. But I did want to make that clear that the only way this request works is if there's a commitment to a second override attempt. This is right.
Yeah, I just, clearly though, the committee had not had an opportunity to really discuss that.
Yes.
Because I believe I had requested that we not really talk about that till after we got through the budget.
Yep.
And at our, is this our first meeting?
Since the budget.
Yep.
Yes.
Right, so this is really our first opportunity to dialogue around that as a committee in public session.
And I think you're really right that it would have been inappropriate to vote a budget with an assumption, first of all, that an override was on the ballot or that there was a particular outcome. I think we had to vote the budget with the information we had.
Right.
So I agree that the process of voting the budget first and then discussing where do we go from here makes a lot of sense.
I think Mr. Robinson? I think I led that discussion, started that discussion, and I was very clear that, crystal clear that it was to give us time to mobilize for an override. I never said that it was in lieu of an override. I said it was to give us time to mobilize, whether that be in April or whether it be a year. My advice at the time was for, you know, to give us a year or whatever, 6 months, and not try to put undue pressure on the Board of Selectmen and others to do that in April. But I'd be open to that discussion. So just the point was very clear that it was never in lieu of an override.
Yeah, it wouldn't make any sense because it's obviously an unsustainable source of revenue. So thank you.
Are we going to have a motion on the table as part of this discussion, or we just want to sort of proceed with some of the discussion? Because
we can start with a motion and have a discussion.
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Robinson.
Move to request that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee over the upcoming weeks to develop and commit to a plan for a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question that will address the current and future needs of the Reading Public Schools as well as any other municipal needs as determined by the Board of Selectmen.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you.
I want to highlight an aspect of that statement.
Yep.
It does not specify the time frame.
Yep.
And I'm hoping we can have a good discussion about that.
Yeah, the motion as read does not specify a particular time frame. I think we need to be sensitive about articulating to the Board of Selectmen what the situation is, and speaking only for myself, I only see one solution. Whether it's this April or next fall or next April, I only see one solution. And so to ask for that, I think, is reasonable. To go too much further than that, I think, is stepping into their sandbox. When will it be? How much will it be? How long will it be? I think we need to be respectful of their process. Mr. Bovin.
I want to be clear in this discussion about where we've gone and where we haven't gone at this point and where we want to go. So as I understand it, we've voted a budget that requires more money than we have revenue.
Yep.
We have, through Mr. Robinson's proposal, requested that money from Financial Committee, and that's where it sits now.
And ultimately, right. Town meeting.
Right, and but that's.
Right.
That's where it sits now. There was a rationale in Mr. Robinson's proposal that included some discussion of an override. But I don't remember having a substantive discussion about what that might look like. It was a rationale for, this is one reason why we might want to vote for this, and all six of us voted for that.
Yep.
From my point of view, I think it would be helpful for this body to identify, you know, what are the problems that we want to solve, because there are many here, and they differ in scope and content. Mr. Robinson's proposal addressed, you know, some of the needs of the schools that have been articulated over the discussions we've had around the budget, but not all. And so my thinking is if we could have a discussion tonight and maybe beyond about what happens, what are our plans, our alternative plans, in the event that, you know, so we cannot authorize free cash spending for our budget. We cannot authorize the selectmen to vote for anything, including, you know, we don't do overrides here. That's not our mission. Our mission is to be experts in education and articulate that for the community. And so if we could come out of tonight with kind of an alternative of what do we want, is there something we want to ask the selectmen to do? What is that? Or how do we get there? Maybe it's just collaborate, which is the motion we have now.
Yeah.
And for what purpose, right? Is it a narrow purpose, just to Mr. Robinson's proposal to talk about, well, is it a contingency plan in the event that the funds are not authorized that we need for the budget that we've passed? Is that the subject of discussion with the selectmen, or is it broader than that? I just want to be clear about what we're asking for.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, I'm not advocating for anything. I'm forming my own impressions from other people's thoughts, but I'd like to hear the committee's thoughts on what is the scope of the problem that we want to address. Is it just contingency planning, or is it something beyond that? And what are there any specific requests we have for our selectmen or for anyone else in the community as a result of our deliberation? So thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, Mrs. Webb.
So I put together some of my thoughts. I've shared them with the committee members. And I, since this discussion had started, I have felt a deep concern about asking the community for an override on the heels of the October override failure. And I would like opportunity to sort of make all of the points as we go through the discussion, but I think for me the most important thing is that we laid out for the community in beginning in July and August and through the town manager's community presentations, which Dr. Daugherty and many of us participated in, and then as we went into August, we laid out very clearly what the repercussions would be for the school services. The only difference fundamentally between prior to the October vote, or what we had there in October, and now, is that we had the opportunity to go through the budget and turn over every rock and look in every place and do our best to not make, I think, prior to October, it said, you know, we would have to cut 20 to 30 teaching positions or staff. And so the only difference is there's not really any new information. It's just that it's definite now because we've been through the budget process and we have a voted budget. But I don't feel like we have, so parents, maybe that's more real to parents. I keep hearing about the energy and you know, the time would be now to pass an override. The thing that concerns me is that we haven't done anything to bring to the table the people who did not support it. And that was a significant loss, and it was a significant voter turnout. It was not a light voter turnout for a local election. It was a good voter turnout for a local election. And there's been, I haven't seen anything that sort of connects that group of people with a more personal impact. The parents who are here are definitely feeling the personal impact. The students who came before us are feeling the personal impact. So I'm very, very concerned for all the reasons that I outlined. I've been in this town since 1978. I was impacted by school budget cuts when I was at Reading High. I have participated in all of the operating override and debt exclusions since the early 90s. And I'm very concerned that we don't have the runway or the scope. And the most important thing to me is that we have a method to try to assure that we don't have to make that middle school cut. Yeah. We have $438,000 that we need of additional cash. Now, I understand town meeting did not support a $7.5 million override, but I just feel like it's our responsibility to.
You mean the voters?
Sorry, the voters did not support that. But what I feel like what. It's our responsibility, and what I want to ask for, based on everything that's happened over the last couple of months, is if there is a way for us to avoid cutting that program in FY18, because that will be the cut. That's what we voted. That will be the cut. Then we should try to do that. And I view Mr. Robinson's proposal as a lower risk, potentially higher probability for success outcome. You can't predict. We can't predict how financial committee is going to respond or how town meeting is going to respond. I understand that. But you have, I don't know how many people on financial committee, 7 or 8?
Nine.
And then 192 town meeting members. And I think we have a very short period of time. And if, let's see, the sequence of events in April is the election is April 4th. Is that correct? So whether there is or is not a override on the ballot, the election is in front of town meeting. So to keep this, you know, on the table, and if the financial committee doesn't end up supporting the additional free cash request that we have, then it still goes to town meeting. If there is an override this April that goes to voters and it is not supported, still we have our last opportunity to avoid that is town meeting. Yeah. And I just feel overall that that's the approach.
One thing that became clear to me personally during the public hearing, the petition signed by hundreds of our students, hearing from so many middle school and high school students and parents and staff, was that the middle school cuts were different because they're much harder to unwind. If additional revenue is found in 6 months or in a year, you've completely restructured a way that you teach something in a way that is very hard to undo. And the other cuts didn't fall under that category. They're still bad, and they still have a negative, and we should mention that. We're still making very significant cuts that will have a negative impact on student achievement. But the feeling from the community was, at least from my perspective, was that those were different. And I think that's certainly what justified my vote last week, was that kind of what you were just saying, we need to do anything we can to prevent that from happening. Dr. Doxer.
So we moved here 20 years ago as part of a migration from Wakefield because of failed overrides. One of the first ones being that we asked in Wakefield, we asked too comprehensive a package and asked for too much money. We had it laid out over years what the improvements were going to be over years, and the feedback was it was too much. I think that what we had in October is not, and what failed in October is not necessarily reflective of what we could bring up before April. I think that we asked for $7.5 million over a long period of time. And if we ask for less money over a shorter period of time with the expectation that there'll be an opportunity to vote again on an override and with the idea in mind of what we have heard back from about operational needs that are capital needs that our town might have or will have, Killam, space needs. So if we're not planning as long term, we're planning to deal with the needs that we have right now that are very apparent, which have generated a lot of awareness and a lot of energy. I think that there were not necessarily just non-school families that voted no. I think that there were, the logs have said, there were a lot of people who have school-age kids that didn't go vote. So now there is an opportunity to reach them. So I think that it is a different scenario. And to your point, Mrs. Webb, I think that we need to try all of our alternatives. And one of those is an override, because I think we need to do our due diligence. I think that if we don't try for an override, we haven't done everything that we can to deal with these dire cuts that will not be, they will cost more to undo than if we can find the means not to make the cuts in the first place. I am very appreciative of Mr. Robinson's proposal, and I think that it was at a perfect time, and I think there was were a lot of ideas shared about where there isn't money to cut. We've turned over every rock. I think we need to ask the voters again for a different override. We need to listen. We need it not to be for as long period of time. We need it not to be as big, because that gives different choice points along the way. But I think we need to ask. And to that end, I'm not sure I want to make an amendment yet, but I want to throw out for discussion that this motion does not include a safety net in terms of making sure our collaboration with the selectmen and our discussion happens in time for the February 28th deadline. Because in order to get something on the ballot, we need to have discussed it, vetted it, and come to a decision before February 28th. And then to your point about the stepping in on toes and being in the selectman's sandbox, I've heard a very clear invitation to give our opinion about what's needed. And I think that that doesn't stop short of when. I think that's part of the discussion. And so if we have an opinion between us that we think an April override would be helpful, I think that it's not stepping on toes to give that opinion. It might not weigh out in the end, but if we don't say it from the beginning, then it won't be weighed in. And so I feel very strongly that that needs to be weighed in. So we need to have this discussion with the selectmen well in advance of the February, well, it's not well in advance now, but we need to have it in advance of the February 28th deadline.
You are absolutely right. If the selectmen make the decision that they want to put something on the ballot for this April, they have, and we have, until February 28th to come up with a number and a rationale. So you're absolutely right about that. And Mr. Boivin, you asked a question that I've been mulling over, which is, what are we asking for here? Is it a one, you know, if we go for an override this April, is it a 1-year fix? Then another override right after that? Is it a 3-year fix? Is it another 10-year fix? Those are all questions that we would have to dialogue with them about. To answer your question, I mean, that is, the last time we went through this process, it was a very, last year, it was a very collaborative would be the word. There was a lot of back and forth. I think Dr. Doherty, you and the town manager worked really well together. There was a lot of kind of, this is where we're at, where are you at, let's have a joint meeting. I think that would all have to happen again, because we can't dictate if it's a 1-year override or a 3-year override or a 10-year override, but we can be part of the discussion.
So that's sort of, that's exactly what my point is about the time frame, because if we do not have the time to really vet that out. I feel like I look at what our community has done in the past to bring people together, where we've had a lot of time for community discussions. We've used the World Cafe process a couple of times, and I think it has had a positive impact. I frankly think we need to take that kind of time. And to come up with something in the next couple of weeks, I really have a concern. We've seen letters to the editor. We got agreed this is anonymous, but still it's a perspective about don't go back, but it's a perspective. Yeah. And I'm really, really concerned about, you know, jamming something down people's throat, and then when we have accomplished a more thoughtful process, the community won't tolerate it. And I just see that, you know, I understand that the financial committee may be very reticent to approve this. But I think it's so that's what we need to emphasize. Look, for the last, just in the last 2 years, right, FY 16 and 17, we cut almost $1.5 million from the school budget. And for FY 18, we're going to cut 813,000 and we're reducing 10.9 FTEs. And staff are actually going to be laid off. They know that. So we will have an opportunity to go speak to FinCom when we, as typical in our process, and defend our budget and defend to them, look, we understand it is not a good habit, it's not preferred, it's risky because maybe it sets a precedent, although it wouldn't be the first time that the committee came. This is an extreme circumstance. I keep reading our policies, and I have done it too many times before where I have approved a budget that has made me sick to my stomach. So frankly, when we were able to approve the budget last week, where we approved it saying, you know what, we're not gonna cut that, we're gonna ask for that additional free cash, I wasn't sick to my stomach that night. I was at least not sick to my stomach from the point of view of what I was doing to students. Certainly I'm uneasy because we don't know the outcome. We don't know what the financial committee will decide. We don't know how the town manager will or won't weigh in front of town meeting. We can't see how that's influenced, but I just feel like we have a group of people who came before us and spent a lot of time with us, and they are motivated. And if their focus is a smaller group of people just to get us through for $588,000 in FY 18, then, you know, that's 201 people that need to be influenced. And I think we have a good case. We have done so much work to cut and cut and cut. So as a community, we should take the time to bring everyone to the table and to the impact sphere, because people are not feeling impacted. And people come to us and they still talk about what class size was in 1967 or 1978, or, you know, people, why do we need more money to educate students now if we have the same number of people in the district? It is a really complicated answer to that question. And I really cannot bring myself to support suggesting this April. The dialogue with the Board of Selectmen and asking them to commit to an override in some period of time is really important to me, and it's important to the overall solution.
I think that to me is critical, and one reason that I'm comfortable with the motion on the table is it gives the Board of Selectmen flexibility to put it on for this April or this fall or next April, all of which is discussion that has to happen. I mean, I think leaving that open, but what it is saying is that we as a school committee would request that plan, that mm-hmm. we commit to a plan, whether it's this April or this fall or next April. So Mr. Robinson, did you have?
No.
Oh, Dr. Doxey.
So I don't argue with you about any of those points, but I think that education has to be ongoing, and I think that even if we do it in a year, what's going to happen is the mantra that derailed so many overrides in the past, but they found the money,
yeah.
is going to haunt us. And if we find the money to stop these cuts, then in the fall or in April, I know we're not filling the $900,000 cuts, but the ones that are other ones that are also impactful, because those other ones, the 900,000, are also impactful.
And fees.
But the ones that are so visible, the ones that the middle school cuts, if they get put back from free cash, which is not free cash, but people who haven't been involved in the process perceive it to be full free cash. And I think the perception is as powerful as the reality. And if we find the money to stop these dire cuts, this
88,000 dollar
cuts, then we're going to be paddling upstream, because people are going to say, we found the money before, so we can find the money again. And I've been involved in overrides that is the mantra, and it's very hard to convince people when you found the money. And when we're talking about people, we've been talking forever about the fact that the schools gave back $500,000. Well, we gave it back because we were conservative planning, and those students who had special needs, who were planned for out of district, didn't come. So it needed legally to be given back to the town. It wasn't that we had extra money. It was that was the deal that legally had to be returned. But that's very hard for people to wrap their brains around. It feels like extra money. And it's not extra money. So if we solve our problems without going to the voters, and again, I don't think we're asking the same thing. It's not the same override. It won't be the same. All of the voters won't have the same knee-jerk reaction. I think it's really important to take it to the voters, as well as our FinCom, as well as our town meeting. We still have something we can do if the override doesn't pass on April 7th.
I think for me, that's why passing this motion is important, because if you go and ask for the free cash, it needs to be coupled with and we're going for an override at a certain point in the near future. I agree with you that without that, asking for the free cash is very challenging, very, very challenging. Mr. Bobbitt.
What does, looking at the language of the motion, and I wasn't able to remember it off the top of my head, but the motion as it's written here, and as was read, says that we're requesting that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee. I mean, I think there's already collaboration, or certainly a spirit of collaboration, from the meetings I've seen recently, and certainly a lot of interest in collaborating. So I guess, what does that mean in addition to what's already going on? I mean, Linda, I think, brought up the point of, could we amend this motion to have a specific, either a deadline or a commitment to have a meeting or something like that? I'm just wondering, in the minds of the other committee members, what does this mean, work in collaboration, that we're not already doing?
We need to have a joint meeting.
Okay,
because we haven't discussed it, so it would have been inappropriate to have a joint meeting with the selectmen, but I think it means we need to have a joint meeting by then, you're saying, a time certain.
But if that's what people are expecting, I'm just trying to summarize what people understand this to mean.
Yeah.
So having a meeting, we could say including having a meeting with this, I'd like the resolution to be more specific in terms of what action is being requested. That's all I have in the motion. I have other topics, but
okay. Yeah, to me, what's going to happen is develop and commit to a plan for a proposition 2.5 override ballot question. So however that happens, whether it's a joint meeting, whether it's leadership from school committee attend a Board of Selectmen meeting, we have there's multiple ways to get there. But to me, the working in collaboration is, you're absolutely right, something we do well and something I'd want to continue to do. To me, the ask is to develop and commit to a plan for a proposition 2.5 override ballot question. That is what we are asking for. Well, that's what the motion that's on the table. Yeah.
So I just wanted to respond to the found the money comment. I think that anyone that's been paying attention and anyone that's votes saw those presentations that, and the reserves and the reserve policies were clearly part of that. That's a question. That's something I said the other night. I haven't heard, but I'm sure it was on a lot of people's mind. And I talked to Barry about it. Was, you know, we sit on a very good reserve position, and I'm not saying that isn't a good thing. But the last time we passed an override in this community, we had under $500,000 in our reserves, total reserves, not just free cash, everything. So part of that proposal was, now we're above a policy, I think you said the other night it's at 7% now, so we're above that policy, so maybe it's a time to consider, you know, since we're, I think we're at 8.5 now or something, I can't remember, somewhere, drawing that down a little more, because I think there are people out there that see that, the people that pay attention see that we do have healthy reserves, and you know, maybe we should be using more of those and take a little more time before we go back out for an override. So that's, I don't think it should be considered found money, because you know, again, if someone's paying attention, they know that, you know, we went to free cash and we told them it was there. It's an idea, an alternative to trying to rush for an override in April.
So. I think that's a really good point. It gives flexibility. You can still do the override in April, but if that is deemed to be too risky, to Mrs. Webb's point, this is a way to solve that problem and not have the really bad systemic cuts.
I think that the other way that I see this is, I know we were asked early on in our budget process, do you ever do two budgets? And I think, you know, one scenario that I see, if the community, we were to decide to wait until FY18 for an override and really process that and figure out what we're going to do, reset some community expectations around, you know, how frequently we're going to have to do that, that would put us in a position next year of probably having to develop two budgets then, because the override would still be in the future. But to FinCom's, you know, to respect FinCom, certainly the base budget wouldn't include the $588,000. You wouldn't be starting from that, because that was money that was given us to free cash in excess of what the guidance was for this year. And I think in terms of getting people sort of energized and motivated and to understand what it means, the difference, again, is that there'll be, next January, if we were doing this, there would be two voted budgets. There would be the voted budget that says this is all the things that, and it would happen if an override does not pass. And if an override passes, then, you know, here's the budget we would be able to pass. That's an idea. I'm not saying that that's like how it would happen. If you decided, if the plan that people agreed upon was a fall override, then this is a little bit different, because, you know, again, it would be more similar to what we went through this year, where we're trying to convey to people, this is what will happen. This is what we anticipate. You know, we don't know until we go through the budget process. Well, we know when we do go through the budget process, then we know sort of with better certainty what the cuts would be. So, you know, the hard part about all of that is, you know, really what this does to our staff as you go through such uncertainty for a long period of time.
That's really true. I think you're right. If you think about back to last summer and fall, when many of us were articulating without the passage of this override, this is the reality we're looking at. I personally didn't hear half of the community input that we've gotten in the last 4 weeks, which is, oh, this is what it looks like, this is what it's going to mean, and it's just a very different thing.
I had a question. Maybe I misheard you, but I thought you said that we obviously wouldn't ask again for the $588,000.
No, I said, what I said, what I meant, and maybe, is that if we can't keep that $588,000 sort of in our budget. In other words, if the Financial Committee or Town Meeting were to provide that in FY18 to avoid the cut, you don't get to ratchet that up.
It's
not in the base.
It's not in the base.
But we'd have to ask for it again.
Well, we'd,
I heard
you
we
wouldn't
be asked.
No, you would take the, I'm just saying to do the budget process, you would take that out of the base. It wouldn't belong there as we would then approach a budget process.
Okay.
Clearly, an override that is not this April but is some point in the future would encompass, you know, we would have the ability to go back to the work that we did in October. We would be looking at where we are now, and we would be able to develop, you know, what should we be doing. Hopefully we could get some community input and understand we should be looking at something that's going to last 4 years or 5 years or 6 years, and then how do we develop that. My point there was, we're asking the FinCom and we're asking Town Meeting to provide us with this additional free cash. And I just want to be really clear that we're not going to like take that and run with it. So it comes out of the base during the next budget cycle. And, you know, really be clear with FinCom that, you know, we are making very significant cuts this year and increases in fees and usage of the revolving accounts.
Yeah, Mr. Robinson.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. We could have very easily taken a very easy path and just gone to the FinCom and said, we can't balance our budget at all, we need $1.4 million. That's it. We didn't do that. We took a deliberate process. There's still significant, difficult cuts here. We're raising fees. We're cutting back on offsets because we're trying to adhere to a more judicious process in that. So it wasn't done without collaboration on everybody's part. So we, as I said, we could have just taken the easy road and said, here, it's yours, we need $1.4 million, and we're not doing that. No one's happy about the cuts that are that remain, but you know, as you know, anyone's willing to disagree with what I propose we put back in, but that's what I thought based on, you know, what I heard from the community and staff and people that put the budget together, those would be the most detrimental in this time frame. So also realizing that it would be disingenuous to ask for the full $1.4 million. So that's where we came up with somewhere in between.
And I think I agree with you completely. And I think that the rationale for protecting or asking for a 1 year, either for an override in April to get it, if that is the direction the Board of Selectmen want to go, or if it isn't going to be this April, if it's going to be at some point in the near, you know, in the next year, to get the free cash for those middle school. I've said this before, but I think it's really important. The middle school cuts are different. They're systemic. They change how we teach foreign language, and they would be very hard to unravel if in 6 or 12 months an override passed. The other cuts we can put back in. We can lower class sizes. We can add sections. We can do things very quickly to unravel the damage. Mm-hmm. But those middle school cuts, I don't see how we can do without really creating pretty serious systemic damage. So I think there's a good rationale for why we asked for the 438. It's for a very specific purpose that involves systemic sustainability. Mr. Robin's been waiting very patiently.
Yeah, just a couple things. First of all, it strikes me that these are really good perspectives from people on the school committee, but we don't have the selectmen in a forum where they can all discuss these, and they're the ones who have the authority over the override. So my suggestion would be to move to craft a motion that would allow us to come together on what we're asking the selectmen to do with the school committee. I would love to have this conversation, but I'd like to have the other people around the table from the selectmen and have it with them in an open forum, because I think their perspective from the last meeting is complementary to ours, and because they're looking at the town situation and some of the considerations, and we have to marry those two areas of the budget together in any proposal. Mm-hmm. So that's my first point, is there anybody who's opposed to the motion or wants to change it, wrap that up, and then what I would like to get through at some point is discussion of what are our priorities, because that's the one thing that only the school committee can do, mm-hmm. is articulate the school committee's priorities to anyone, right, and say, so we've had a lot, Mr. Robinson and our chairperson have talked about the structural cuts to the middle school is $438,000 that would effectively take away quite a bit of middle school language in seventh grade and most of it in eighth grade, make it an elective in eighth grade. It would change the class periods from 7 to 6 periods. So that's clearly something that everybody's talking about. So I'd like to just be explicit as a committee about, is this what we want to do first if we were to get free cash? Is that the first thing we would want to do with it? If we were to make proposals with, you know, or a specific request to the selectmen, is that the content of our proposal, or is it something different? So I'd like to wrap up the motion, this may be my proposal, and then go into the discussion of priorities or something else, whatever you want to go in, but I see these two as separate issues.
Can I respond? So yes. I think that, sorry.
Go ahead.
This is very respectful. I think the time to have done that was when we voted on the vote. We voted to ask for additional free cash, and you know, we were very specific as to what we were going to put it for, and it wasn't just middle school, it was also the kindergarten paraeducators and the science curriculum. So I think what you're saying now is we re-vote that and change that li-
It wasn't the paraeducators, just the science curriculum.
You raised the kidding eye and tuition.
I'm sorry, yeah.
I just wanted for anyone at home.
Just
it's
to
only,
clarify.
The free cash request is for two reasons.
It's been a lot of these meetings.
No.
I'm
you can
sorry.
Keep going. I'm sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to correct that.
So I guess I just throw that out there. I mean, that was kind of the priority we set after mm-hmm. that vote, or within that vote, and now it sounds like.
We can't change that.
Yeah.
Can I respond to that?
Yes.
Yeah. Not the way I intended
my
comment. What I was saying is we have a vote, we have a 6-0 vote on a budget that requires another group's action.
Yep.
I'm thinking of contingencies in the event that, for whatever reason, that we would just get you get a different amount of money, you don't get the full amount that you asked for. Are those our priorities? I'm just asking the question. I'm not saying we revote anything. I'm just saying, let's be clear about 1, 2, 3. This is what we would like to do in the event that additional revenue became available. I'd also like to point out my understanding of the 438, confirm this is correct, is that it's not an incremental thing. And maybe this is a question for Dr. Daugherty to confirm, but the cost of the middle school restructuring, we can't undo it by a quarter simply by getting 25% of the funds. That's an all or nothing package. You get 438,000,
the whole model,
seven FTE funded.
Yeah.
Or you can't undo it. So that's a big thing. No, I wasn't suggesting that we revote anything at this. Now, I just like to vote on a clear motion, a request to the selectmen, have a discussion with them. I'm in favor of that. I think that would be very productive. But just that they can't speak in this forum.
Yeah.
And then move on to a discussion about what are our thoughts individually and then as a committee for, in the event there's a need for a contingency plan, because we don't have control over whether the budget we passed will take effect or not at this point. And what is that contingency plan? Thank you.
Dr. Doxer.
Yes,
okay. Well, maybe I'm misunderstanding, but I think that the answer to your question, Mr. Bovin, is that if we don't get this money, we don't have the science curriculum or the language, and it's gone.
Right.
And that damage that's not hard to unravel is gone. It's done. The damage is done. And so I don't see setting priorities within that. It's we don't get the money, we don't have those programs this time around. Mm. And that then my vote for having an override, we have to have the override. Just a comment on Ms. Borowski's comment about damage that's hard to unravel. I think that, yes, if we cut the science if we cut the language program, it's very hard to unravel that. But if we don't find the funds to mitigate the cuts that we're making, there's a lot of damage that's going to be very hard to unravel. And if we, and I'm going to be very careful with the way I present, I say this.
Okay.
But if we end up putting all the weight on upcoming negotiations, as were insinuated by the selectmen, then that also can do a lot of damage. And that's all I'm not going farther than that, but I think it's wrong to put all that pressure on those negotiations.
Dr. Daugherty.
I think I want to try to answer Mr. Bowman's question.
Okay.
I think what you were asking is, if the direction, whether it be in April or further, is for an override, what would that look like in terms from a school committee perspective, the priorities?
I'm not sure that was my question, but.
Okay, I thought that's where you were going for
I
a little
did.
Bit.
Go ahead. Yeah, in the event that, so as I understand it, we passed a budget and that the finance committee, the town meeting, the town manager has authority, just bottom line authority. They can cross out the number that you wrote and write in a different number that balances the budget. It could be exactly what it originally was. It could be some number in between, and they're just going to give us a number. I guess what I'm not clear on is what happens then. If that's what happens and we get a number that's different and it comes back to us, and it doesn't have to be a bucket of $438,000 or a bucket of $500 and whatever thousand, right? It could be some number in between. My question is, what happens then? Does it come back to the school committee to figure out, well, we've got less money? Does the superintendent exercise your role?
So that's where I was.
So if you could explain it. So it doesn't have to do with an override. If you just get a different number and you just cross it out, we've got a budget that required additional funds. We have that number crossed out. and now we have less than that amount. But who connects that reduced amount to what cuts are actually made? That's what I don't understand.
That's what, I mean,
so let's let Dr. If I can,
please.
So the same way that we put this budget together is the same way we would do that process. So I would sit down with my central office team, the principals, and say, okay, here's the picture. It's changed. What are your recommendations? And then I would come back to the committee, and I would say, here is what we would recommend to the committee as what the changes would be.
So,
is that kind of akin to last year? We'd requested $150,000 from free cash for the science curriculum year one, and then it turned out that there was operating revenue from multiple sources that equaled that money. So we voted a budget asking for free cash for 150, and then we revoted when the circumstances changed and there was another way to fund that year one. We revoted a smaller budget number.
Correct.
So that's a similar.
Correct.
We did that last year. This is
I just really want to emphasize, though, that it has to be really clear that the cuts that will be made if that funding doesn't come through are the cuts that we've outlined. Because the financial committee members and town meeting members have to understand what they're basing a decision on, and we can't change that. Yep. So we've been talking a lot about the $438,000, and that has to be one bucket. I think the $150,000 for the science curriculum, you know, there's been a lot of dialogue about that, and that was in a sense an expectation previously, and maybe there was some confusion around that, and it would. And that's that from a perspective of approving the money, that's a non-recurring expense. So, you know, I feel like if you were to look at, you know, we might be likely, let's say, to get the $150,000. No, but that doesn't mean if we get the $150,000 for the science curriculum, I think, from my perspective, that's how we should apply it, because that's the understanding that people are using to make the decision. And it wouldn't be like you could put two of the language teachers, right? We're not going to
do that.
So I think that's a very, very important point, because people have to understand that about our process.
Right. There is either the passage of a successful override before FY18 starts.
Or town meeting.
Town meeting approves the use of free cash to band-aid this for 1 year. Or those cuts get made in the middle school. I think those are the three pathways.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So it sounded like there was still, in the event that the bottom line number is not what we approved, it sounded like it comes back to this committee again. And this is why the priorities discussion, linked to your question, I think matters. And I'm not suggesting we move the goalposts here. I'm just suggesting we be really explicit about what the goalposts are. And so it sounds like there's a lot of discussion around the 438 and the keeping the middle school language. I support that as a high priority. Implementing the science curriculum, I support that as a high priority. And so what I'm saying is, in the event that it comes back to this body again, or other groups are deliberating, if we give them cash, what will they use? If the school committee gets more cash, what will they use it for? Or if it's not the budget that they proposed, it seems helpful to me to give some indication of what we would do collectively in the event that we got some, but not all of the resources we had hoped for.
And I'm going to ask Dr. Dougherty for this. To me, it would depend on the amount.
If
health insurance premiums, suddenly there was good news on state aid or health insurance premiums, the answer to your question, if it's a $25,000 improvement versus a $200,000,
right.
Clearly if it's $430,000, we know what we're going to do.
Well, do we? That is exactly my question.
Yes. It's not a discussion of priorities.
Yeah, we voted that.
Right.
But we voted a package, and if that number gets changed at the bottom line, isn't the whole package, like, you don't have a budget anymore?
No, we approved $813,000 of cuts, and certain FTEs are impacted, and it was very well defined. But when we approved the budget, we also said, you know what, we're not going to make that middle school cut and the science curriculum cut. They're too important. Mm-hmm. So we're asking the financial committee and then subsequently town meeting for that additional money. That is what we've asked for. We don't have to prioritize that. That's what we asked for. That's what we said. Mm-hmm. In terms of if state aid comes in or
some number is different.
That's even, let's just say, above the 438. Maybe they approve it, and then some other number comes in. We, according to our policy, Dr. Dougherty, as our CEO and his leadership team and the principals,
will develop a recommendation based on their expertise of what's best for student outcomes, you know, given the situation, and then they will make a recommendation for us. I don't think we can really do that in advance right now. I also feel like, we need the time to, we would need a little bit more time to decide that.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And we did a lot of work. It's all outlined in what we put together as a structural deficit and our needs, the 1.8 million of additional needs. We would obviously need to go back to that. I frankly don't feel like we have the scope to do that justice right now. And that's my personal opinion, why I just really want to focus on this, and I want to focus on a different method to get the community to come together. But the process, I realize it's probably time for me to be off this board, but it's my first 7 years, and this is four years, so by the time I'm done, it'll be another 4 years. And we have always, when we work with Superintendent Scatini and Superintendent Daugherty, there's always been that process of, we are getting the recommendation on the best application of the funds, and then we as a committee are vetting that and investigating that and asking the questions. But we rely on that expertise. And I think that that's a transparent process. Maybe the community doesn't think that that is, but I believe it to be.
Yeah, Mr. Bob.
Well, I think Chuck, it follows on nicely with the only point.
Me too. Go ahead.
I don't find what you're saying controversial. I just want to understand what happens if you don't get, you've asked for, it sounds like there's two major items there. One of them is 150K, the other one is priced 7 FTE at 438K.
Right.
And so what I'm saying is, what if you don't get both? What if you get a number that's in the middle? What happens then, right? That's what's, right, so
we
it goes
to
Dr. Daugherty.
You send it back to them and say, we didn't get what we asked for, what's the best application of these additional revenues?
But does that go back through the, then we would re-vote. This is my point.
He would bring it back to us.
Can I try to
clarify
this?
What would we do first? What would we do second? That's what I'm trying to understand.
If I can try to clarify this.
Okay, Dr. Daugherty.
At the end of town meeting each year, you vote on whatever town meeting has voted on, whatever the line is, and then you also take a vote on each cost center.
Right.
And you would do the same thing this year. When town meeting takes a final vote, sometime in mid-May, the next school committee meeting, the school committee takes a vote on the bottom line and the five cost centers. You've always done that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you. This is helpful because I haven't been part of the process. So,
yeah.
I think Ms. Webb was saying this, but I just wanted to be clear, and especially with Mr. Doxer, Mr. Berman here. I mean, if we were to get better health insurance results, or state aid came in better, my first, I'm speaking, and this is part of what I propose, my first goal would be to give that right back to whatever, if the FinCom had authorized you, we would take that right off the top, it would go right back to whatever, so we would get the net difference.
Right.
I think you said that, but that, I wanted to be clear,
right,
on
that.
Right,
that's a timing issue of when that would come in. So saying that they allocated the
funds. We wouldn't
take
both.
Right.
Just to piggyback on that, if you remember a few years ago, we used to have to wait for state aid numbers to come in and health insurance numbers to come in. I believe it was 3 years ago, we made a decision, I believe the Finance Committee was on board with this, is that we were going to assume a certain number. For those, and that anything above or below would be either taken out of free cash or put back into free cash. That way we wouldn't have to wait and try to figure out our budgets after the school committee's already passed a budget.
And that piggybacks with what, so we asked for money for the middle school, and all of a sudden our expenses were lower because of the health insurance.
Right.
Then we would give back that
portion.
So to Mr. Bovin's point earlier, because I think it was compelling,
we've
had a good discussion about some of the relative pros and cons of different approaches towards a next override. But really the next step is we need to talk with the Board of Selectmen. Unless anyone has anything substantively that they would want to add, Dr. Doxer.
So I would actually like to make it our motion specific so that we don't get shut out of the potential for an April override.
Okay.
So that we collaborate with them before the April, before the February 28th deadline.
So right now the motion reads, over the upcoming weeks. What I'm hearing you saying is by February 28th, 2017.
Can we ask the member of the selectmen who's here how we might craft this motion in a way that might meet their needs?
We can ask
them. Tomorrow, and we have a posted meeting on the 21st.
Right. So we can...
Yeah. A good next step might be for...
Doesn't mean that we can't meet more times?
Right. But that's just the schedule. You just need 48 hours, right?
Yeah. That's right.
That is correct.
So we would meet maybe before February 28th in the event that action needs to be taken. I mean,
there is a scheduled meeting for the 21st. Right. I don't know what the agenda is on, obviously.
I should say by the 24th maybe would be better.
I'm sorry. You made a motion. I did not hear a second. You made an amendment.
Second.
Thank you. Thank you. Just before we discuss it, let's for
yes,
the minutes.
The
thank you.
That is school vacation week.
Okay. So maybe I'll ask this. Does anyone else have an amendment to the motion? I'm going to use town meeting rules. We're going to limit ourselves to two amendments before we go crazy. No more amendments.
Can you read it one more time, please?
Sure. Right now, it the motion as read, move to request that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee over the upcoming weeks to develop and commit to a plan for a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question that will address the current and future needs of the Reading Public Schools, as well as any other municipal needs, as determined by the selectmen. Your amendment, Dr. Doxer, is to remove the words over the upcoming weeks and replace them with by February 28th, 2017.
Prior to, maybe.
Yes.
Prior to. Got it.
Friendly
amendment accepted. Got it. discussion on the amendment.
Can I ask the selectman in the audience a question?
You're never going to come to our meetings again. Go ahead. They're scintillating. I know, serious.
Oh, that's not fair.
I do. Just
and just to be clear, Mr. Berman, thank you for being here tonight.
Thank
and you can certainly speak from your perspective as a selectman, but I don't
I'm
want
sorry.
Anyone thinking that he is speaking for the board.
No.
You are not speaking for the board.
And I'm not asking on behalf of the board. I'm just asking in terms of scheduling. If we wanted to, are there two meetings in February?
We'd be tomorrow.
Right. And then
on the 21st.
So we have, I don't know that.
Valentine's Day would probably not be a good
day. I think it would be helpful to ask for, we could request an agenda item from them as part of this.
I think you have an agenda item tomorrow night.
We have an agenda item just, to, you know, yeah.
So.
Okay.
I mean, it's a public meeting.
Yeah.
I think that's another possibility is that you might get some attendance from school committee members to answer to where we're at right now and what this motion intends.
You might want to let the chairman know.
Will do.
If it's a joint meeting, we could have more than four people there.
We have not posted. You need to post
48
hours.
So
in
we
advance.
Could do that
for
the 21st.
For Wednesday night, though.
That was
just so you know. You are posted for Wednesday night.
For the finance committee.
And then, so we could try to do the 21st as a joint.
Mm-hmm. Or we can schedule a meeting sooner if need be.
Okay.
There's a lot of options.
That's school vacation week, and we would prefer, I know we would not schedule our own meetings on school vacation week, so.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to be out of the country that on the 21st. So.
And you'll also not have Gail or myself.
Right, so
you
we would want to try to work with the selectmen to schedule it not on Valentine's Day, but that week.
Sure. So the motion on the table, the amendment on the table, do we want to have any discussions on the relative value of over the upcoming weeks or to the specific date of February 28th?
I think this is adequate. I think there's a lot of motivation to get people together to have an open conversation that'll advance the issues.
I'm in favor of the amendment.
With the amendment, I think this is adequate to give us the flexibility to do that in the most appropriate way.
I'm concerned about the amendment because I feel that the Board of Selectmen are very clear that February 28th is their deadline if they want to move forward with an April override. And to your point about scheduling, if they make a decision that that's not the direction we're going in, I would hate for us to have a motion that said, well, we want a decision by February 28th. If they make the decision we're not going to go for this April, you can take a couple weeks. Do you know? This puts a lot of pressure.
Oh, yes.
So I would advocate for keeping it as I don't think I'll be supporting the amendment. Dr. Dawson.
The way I'm hearing the amendment doesn't say the discussion has to be done by February 28th.
It says...
It says we have to meet with them by, prior to...
It says develop and commit to a plan. Which to me means, is it September, is it November, is it next April, is it this April, a plan?
How about, can we...
Yes, go ahead.
Could we say, and I'll, maybe it would be a second amendment, I don't know if it's friendly or not, would be to say including an initial meeting prior to a date?
I think the next step is for a couple of us to attend tomorrow night's selectman meeting and have this discussion with them. To figure out what their process is, because they may have a whole bunch of ideas that will impact this.
Well, what if the language, to your point, were to say an initial plan? To commit to an initial plan, and that way it's not committing to the fall or to the spring if April doesn't happen. It's
because when we go to finance committee and town meeting, I think we need a plan. That's my take.
I think that leaves that open. If we say we want to commit to an initial plan before February 28th, then that leaves, we can still have a plan before we go to FinCom or town meeting. But it doesn't shut down the process if April is ruled out. Am I misunderstanding?
No, I hear you. I mean, at the grand scheme, we're talking about the words over the upcoming weeks or prior to February 28th, which mean virtually the same thing, so I don't know if there's any other discussions on the amendment.
One question.
Yep.
Would you be more comfortable with for evaluating a proposition 2.5?
No. Okay. I think that's a separate amendment.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a whole separate kettle of fish.
This is just a plan. This is an approach.
What is the plan? Yep. No, yeah, Mr. Robinson?
Yeah, I guess I'm comfortable with the chair spent a lot of time putting this motion together. And, you know, I think I've heard amongst the table here that nobody's looking for a way out. We're all going to make ourselves available to try and get this up for immediate discussion.
Yeah.
So. It goes.
So can I change the wording of my amendment? Because I'm still stuck on the February 28th. I just am thinking.
Oh, I don't know what the Roberts rules of order are on changing an amendment.
Just withdraw
if
it.
Oh, you can withdraw your amendment.
Yeah, you can withdraw it.
Thank you. You can withdraw your.
And then propose a different.
Mm-hmm.
Amendment. So I'll withdraw my amendment and
okay.
Then propose that develop and commit to an initial plan for the Prop 2.5 override ballot question. So I'm sorry, before that, with the school committee before February 28th.
Could you read the entire motion the way you want it to read?
Yes, I could.
Thank you.
Move to request that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee prior to the February 28th deadline.
Can we just say February 28th, 2017?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Prior to February 28th, 2017, to develop and commit to an initial plan for a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question.
And the rest of the motion as it's written?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Can you reread it?
Yeah. The new amendment says, move to request that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee prior to February 28th, 2017 to develop and commit to an initial plan for a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question that will address the current and future needs of the Reading Public Schools as well as any other municipal needs as determined by the selectmen. Discussion on the amendment. Are we ready for a vote?
So I would interpret the word plan to include a list of action items.
Yep.
Okay.
What are we doing?
Not
adding
a
more to it?
No.
I'm asking
if there's any discussion
mean?
Or are we ready
oh.
for a vote on the amendment?
Yeah, so this, as I understand the word plan, it means we leave a meeting prior to February 28th with a list of action items for what we're gonna do next. And that fulfills the resolution.
It's a development and commitment to a plan for an override. So what is the plan for an override?
An initial plan.
Yes, an initial plan.
Which,
that's the amendment.
Which at, which might be.
Just a date.
It might be not this April, some other time, or it might be this April.
Correct.
Yep.
Correct.
And that might be as much as we get at this point in time.
Yes, yes.
We can't hold the,
Correct.
Okay.
Any other discussion on the amendment?
Can I just ask a clarifying question?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I don't mean, I just. Are you proposing in this amendment that there be a posted meeting of the Board of Selectmen and School Committee by February 28th?
Not necessarily.
Because so tomorrow night.
I think tomorrow
could
night.
Could be.
Yes.
Could fulfill this resolution.
Except we're not posted, so it would be our.
It's not.
Yeah.
A sub.
Well, that's why I just asked. So
yes.
It doesn't necessarily have to be a posted meeting.
If we have a passed motion from this committee, I think a couple of us can go to the Board of Selectmen's meeting tomorrow night and say the school committee has discussed, here's what we think the next step is, this is what we pass.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just wanted
and
to
then
make sure.
The outcome
yeah.
of that might be we need to sit together or Dr. Doherty and the town manager. Like there are a myriad of ways that they can go,
yeah. So
but we really need to talk to them.
This allows us to have fewer than four people in the room and still speak as the committee.
Precisely.
Yes.
And question. So the impact of this motion, I just want to clarify, is that we are, as a, if we all vote for it, we are as a body saying we are committed to an override and we want to collaborate with the selectmen to that.
I
so
don't
I just
know
want
that,
that to be
I agree with that. I think we're, I'm sorry.
You don't?
No,
we're
I didn't,
to a plan.
I didn't recognize.
We're
I apologize. Ms. Elaine was, I think
yes,
she was up
ahead.
First. She
thank
needed
you.
To.
I, just, I really want to make sure that from my perspective, we're committing to have this dialogue because there should be a plan, because we're asking FinCom and town meeting for additional free cash. And one of the things we want to show is that we are serious about being able to restore that free cash that we've asked for. The only way for us to do that is for a Proposition 2 and a half operating override at some point in time. It, all other things being equal, no other money.
In FY 17 or 18, before
right.
FY 19. Yep.
Right, before FY 19. So, but I still, this, I don't think that this motion should be interpreted to mean that we support an override this April, next October, or FY 18 April. It doesn't actually say that. It just says we need to address that, because if you think about FY 19 without an override, then there's I know there's people in this room that won't be here then, because they're just not gonna do that to their kids. So I'm sure that we need to address this as a community. We really need to have a much more involved, well thought out, well structured community discussion. But I'm supporting this motion because the way I look at it, by the time we're looking at doing FY19's budget, we need an override.
Mr. Bobbin?
Yeah, I'm supporting the motion because I believe it's a mechanism to get the two groups together in a forum where they can have an open discussion under the applicable public meeting laws. So it doesn't, in my mind, commit anybody to any course of action other than having that discussion. And then coming up with a plan, which in my mind is a very flexible word, but it requires some kind of action items or a to-do list or something. And within that, there are many possibilities that could result from that, but I don't feel that we're the body to speculate about what those might be,
yep.
But we're an essential part of the solution for the town and the schools here.
And I think what you just said is important. This doesn't endorse any particular proposed override. During the last process, once the Board of Selectmen said we're going to ask for $7.5 million, it's going to potentially be sustainable for a decade, it will cover these purposes, we then had a discussion as a body and took a position on it.
Right.
But you're right, you wouldn't take a position on an override until you knew what the amount was, what the purpose was. So this is just saying that we would like to have the discussion and have a plan in place. Okay, Dr. Doxer.
So my question is, listening, do we want to have a statement in the front of this that says we are committed, we do think an override is necessary.
That's what it says.
We move to request.
I think it says that.
It says that.
That's the question. It's clear enough?
Yeah.
I think so.
Okay.
Any other discussion on the amendment, which changes over the upcoming weeks to prior to February 28, 2017, and changes commit to a plan to commit to an initial plan? No more discussion? Are we ready for a vote on this? All those in favor of the... I'm sorry?
On the amendment.
This is not the overall motion. This is Dr. Doxer's amendment with those language changes. All those in favor of the amendment? All those opposed? That is 4-1, and the motion carries. Let's move on to a discussion of the amendment. I'm sorry, the overall motion. Move to request that the Board of Selectmen work in collaboration with the school committee prior to February 28, 2017, to develop and commit to an initial plan for a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question that will address the current and future needs of Reading Public Schools, as well as any other municipal needs as determined by the selectmen. Any more discussion from the committee on this motion? Is there anyone in the public who wanted to speak to this motion?
Everybody's
just
terrified.
Just here for the scintillating conversation.
We'll just take a deep breath.
We're ready for a vote? All those in favor of the motion? It passes 5-0. All right. Well, oh.
Wait, is that because it was like a root canal or? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I don't know how to interpret that.
That is for taking action. That is for taking action.
Well, thank you. I think I've been on the committee for 3 years, and that's the first applause. So. And it's been a long month.
Can I just make a suggestion?
Yes, Mr. Berman.
Either yourself or Dr. Daugherty, just sort of let our chair and maybe the manager know that you're planning on coming to the meeting tomorrow.
Yep.
Or some, a faction of your group. Just to
I'm going
to
see town manager tomorrow.
Can you communicate that? I'll zip an email to the chair and the vice chair. And it will not be the entire committee. We're not posted, but there will be a couple of us. I will be able to be there tomorrow evening.
So can I just... Can I ask who is planning on being there? Because, like, if I'm not on the list, then I want to make sure that I get to talk to whoever's going to be there a little bit more. No.
I will be there.
And that was my question.
And Mr. Robinson will be able to be there.
And
you were not?
No. So then it's just me and you. Rock, paper, scissors.
Well, why don't we talk
tomorrow?
No,
I'm just kidding. I was
totally
kidding.
Reach out to me if you want to come.
I'll go Wednesday night. You go Tuesday night.
We're posted for Wednesday night.
Right.
So that's a deal.
Okay.
I believe that's it for tonight in public session. We have a motion.
Oh, God.
Excuse me. Move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining to the approval of minutes and not to return to open session.
Is there a second?
Question.
I need a second on that right now.
Second.
Okay. What's your question?
So, we're stopping all the discussion, but to Mr. Woodman's, I keep pronouncing your name wrong. I'm so sorry.
I know who you're talking to.
point. So when we go to the selectmen and they ask us for an override number.
Whole separate discussion.
That's not
that's
for tomorrow.
That's a lot of future stuff. There's a bazillion things to be
and if and it depends what time frame it ends up being, the plan ends up being.
All of it. Yeah, that's right. A lot of future discussion.
And maybe this is a question for another meeting. No, we didn't, because before we vote on this.
Yeah, we need to go into executive. So last
we vote on executive.
Well, it's not a kind of a question. So I still feel that I haven't fully had my initial question answered, and we can do this in a separate meeting if that's the appropriate thing. But in the event that Plan A doesn't work, that we don't get the budget we requested funded. You know, as I understand, I just want to make sure I'm clear on what happens then. And I'm not clear on what happens next. And not having gone through the process as a school committee member, and perhaps there are people at home who are joining the process late that may want to know
so
the same
I'm
thing.
So I'm going to suggest that we have an offline conversation with Dr. Daugherty and myself. And if you're still not satisfied with whatever questions you have, we'll put it on a future agenda.
And if there's a way to inform the public of that, I think that
fine.
Would be helpful too. So
yep.
It's fine. As long as we get the message out there so people understand the steps. And I don't know,
yep.
Maybe posting a document or something of this is what happens if.
Great.
I'm really concerned about that, about people understanding what happens if they don't get the money.
I don't understand what's not
clear. Yeah, I was going to say.
If we don't get the money,
yeah.
that $438,000, if we don't get the $438,000, we cut those seven teachers, we do not have seventh grade language, we have an eighth grade elective, and we don't have sixth grade ELA. That's what happens. If we get the $150,000 because FinCom is okay about a little bit more about a non-recurring, then we use the $150,000 for the science curriculum. If we don't get the $150,000, we don't use it for the science clicker. That is, we voted that. That's clear. I have been checking in with people, all kinds of people, over the last 2 weeks. What's your understanding of what we did? I've checked in with members of the FinCom. They're meeting Wednesday, and they're going to be talking about this. They know, or it is their assumption, if that's not approved, those will be the cuts. That's how we voted it. I just don't see, there's no other question. If some amount of money that's different from $588,000 gets approved by the
somehow
by town meeting or by town meeting or eventually comes in as state aid, then we would have to have Dr. Daugherty would be giving us a recommendation, because if it's anything less than $438,000, we can't do the middle school piece.
Correct.
Right. So if we get $438,000 from some source, clearly it's going to go to the middle school program, because that's what we have as the cut. I don't know why. I can't see what's not straightforward
about
this.
So what I'm proposing, Mrs. Webb, is that Mr. Bovin have an offline conversation with Dr. Daugherty and myself to answer whatever questions he has about the process and about what happens and what if this and what if that and how about this. And then as a result of those discussions, we will put anything on the agenda that he or anyone else feels is necessary. I just don't think it's a discussion for
right
now.
Yeah, there's a motion on the table.
We're trying to go into executive session, and we've gotten off topic. Executive session, we have a second. Roll call vote. Mr. Bovin?
Yes.
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 I'm a yes. Good night.